Okay, so let us start the class. So I hope the screen is visible to you.
Yes, sir.
Okay, so I'll again start from the previous lecture, because in the previous lecture many of the students could not join. So I'll again repeat those things and then I'll upload. Right? So in fact, before this lecture we had talked about the base current mechanism in the BJTs, and we found that base current is due to the recombination in the base and also due to injection into the emitter region. Then we also commented on the saturation region. So why this saturation region is coming into picture, what is saturating? So we said that the collector current actually saturates here and actually it becomes maximum. And in this region, that is saturation region, this collector current, which is attaining a maximum value, so it does not changes with the base current now. So even if the base current is changed, the collector current remains constant and saturated in this region. So that is why we said that the saturation and cutoff regions can be utilized for switching purpose. That is, open and closed switch can be utilized in the cutoff and saturation regions. And the active region, which was left in the middle, so this can be utilized for the amplification purpose, because here the base current can be amplified, so that IC is beta IB relation works here. That is, this relation IC is beta IB, so this can work in active region. So one can think of amplifying the collector current by applying a small base current. So depending upon beta of the transistor, the collector current can be modified. So now let us today talk about again the amplification in BJTs. Okay, so what is this beta and how to calculate it? So we have to understand, so far we have only said that the collector current depends on beta, so but what is beta? So that we have to understand. Okay, so now let us say that we want to amplify, or we want to achieve a collector current, and that collector current is dependent on the base current. So we want to amplify actually this base current, so that the output current is amplified and output current is the collector current. Let's say we have a PNP transistor. Okay, PNP transistor we have. So in a PNP transistor, the holes are emitted from the emitter, they come into base and then they are collected at the collector. Okay. Now let us assume that this emitter current is completely because of holes. Okay, that is, emitter current is made up entirely of holes. Okay, and so collector current is also, since collector current is almost equal to the emitter current, so we say that collector current is also now made of entirely holes which are emitted from the emitter. Okay, so we are not considering these electrons which are coming from the base to the emitter region, right? So we are neglecting the emitter, the base to emitter transport of electrons. So we say that emitter current is only dependent on the hole. So this is our first assumption. Okay. Now, if it is true, then this collector current should be proportional to the hole component of the emitter current. Okay. That is, this collector current should be proportional to IE. Right. So I'll write IC, that is, collector current should be proportional to the whole component of the emitter current. Let us say IE is the whole component, IE is the emitter current and the whole component is IEP. Okay. So if we remove this proportionality sign and we bring in this beta, which is constant of proportionality. Now this is not beta, actually this is B only, and this B is called base transport factor. Okay. So this base transport factor here means, since the holes are coming into the base from emitter, so the fraction of holes which actually cross the base and reach collector. Okay, so I'll again repeat, the fraction of holes which are in the base due to the emitter. Right, so emitter has emitted the holes. The holes are now in the base. Now the fraction of these holes which cross the base and reach the collector. So that is actually the base transport work factor, or B. Okay, so B is the base transport factor. Now the current, in fact the emitter current, so this emitter current is made up of holes also and electrons also. If we consider these electrons, that is electrons which are coming from the base to emitter, okay, so then the total emitter current will be dependent on both the transfer of hole from emitter to base and the current due to transfer of electrons from base to emitter, right? So that is the total emitter current. If I say that total emitter current is IE, so then IE would be equal to the emitter current due to holes, that is IEP, and the emitter current due to electrons, right? So total IE, that is emitter current, would be dependent on both the emitter current due to electrons and holes. So one can write IE as IEN plus IEP, and then one can also introduce another term which is called emitter injection efficiency, gamma. Okay. So this emitter injection efficiency gamma is given by this relation, that is IEP divided by IEN plus IEP. Okay. Emitter injection efficiency is given by this relation. Now if the emitter injection efficiency is 100%, or I want emitter injection efficiency to be 1 or 100%, so for this the current component due to electrons could be 0. If this component, that is current component due to electron, is 0, so if this is 0, then obviously the emitter injection efficiency would be 1 around 1 or 100%. Okay. So that is the emitter current if it is only made of holes, okay, that is no contribution from electron, then the emitter injection efficiency could be 100%. Okay. Now if I say B is 1, that is base transport factor is 1, that is if B is 1, that is base transport factor is 1, then that means there is no recombination in the base. So all holes which are present in the base, they are transferred to the collector. So if B is 1, that is base transport factor is 1 here, so obviously that means collector current would be equal to the emitter current due to holes. That means all holes which were emitted or injected by the emitter into the base, they cross the base and reach the collector. Okay. That is collector current is equal to emitter current due to holes. Okay. If the base transport factor is 1, so which means there is no recombination of holes in the base. Now from this one can find out a relationship between the collector and emitter, okay, currents. Okay, so that is one can write the collector current IC divided by the emitter current IE. Okay, so IC, we had already said it is B, that is base transport factor, multiplied by IEP, emitter current due to holes. I'll go back here and show you this one. IC is BIEP, right? So I say IC is BIEP, that is base transport factor, multiplied by the emitter current due to holes, divided by the emitter current. So this total emitter current is due to the emitter current due to both electrons and holes. Okay. Now this term, that is IEP divided by IEN plus IEP, so this is what we have already defined over here in the previous slide, IEP by IEN by plus IEP. So that is actually emitter injection efficiency gamma. So one can replace this term, that is this term, by gamma. Okay. So we say that IC by IE, that is collector to emitter, collector current divided by emitter current, is beta B times gamma. Not beta, B times gamma. And this B gamma can further be represented by this alpha. Okay. And this alpha is called current transfer ratio, or this represents emitter to collector current amplification. Okay. That is IC is now alpha times IE. That is collector current can be amplified by sorry, not collector current, emitter current multiplied by alpha. So that will give you the collector current. That is, emitter current can be amplified by this vector alpha. But since this alpha, the value of this alpha is always less than one or near one, so actually there is no amplification of emitter current. Okay. So emitter current is not amplified here. Since alpha is less than 1, okay, so emitter current, if multiplied by alpha, so that will result a collector current which will always be less than the emitter current. Though the name is current amplification factor, but it does not provide any amplification, but still the name is the emitter to collector current amplification factor, right? Alpha. But there is actually no amplification since alpha is smaller than unity. So we have found now the relationship between the collector and emitter currents. So similarly, one can find out the relationship between the collector current and the base current. Okay. Now for calculating the base current, again, we will bring this base transport factor into picture. And this base transport factor B is actually the fraction of injected holes which are actually crossing the base without recombination, right? So base transport factor B is fraction of injected holes which are crossing the base without recombination. So then that would mean that 1 minus B would be the fraction of holes recombining in the base. So if B is the fraction of holes which are crossing the base without recombining, so that means 1 minus B is the fraction of holes recombining in the base. So using this, one can find out the total base current. So in fact, the base current will also depend upon the emitter current, right? So in fact, the emitter current is coming into base, and then the same emitter current is going into the collector. So as we have written, the emitter current is equal to the emitter current due to both electrons and holes. Okay? So base current can also be written in terms of emitter current, because base current and emitter current seems to be same here. Same emitter current is going into the base. So one can write a relationship between base current and emitter current. That is, the base current is equal to the emitter current due to electrons plus the emitter current due to holes multiplied by the holes which are recombining in the base, 1 minus B. So that way one can find out the base current. Okay. Now, once we have known the base current, so the base current, the same emitter current is flowing into the base. But this time in the base, some of the holes are recombining. Okay. So the holes which are recombining are given by 1 minus B. So the emitter current which is inside the base due to the total number of holes, since 1 minus B is the holes which are recombining in the hole in the base. So that would be equal to IEN plus, that is emitter current due to electrons, plus the contribution of emitter current due to holes multiplied by the fraction of holes which are recombining in the base. Okay. So that will be total base current, because from here also one can understand that the holes are recombining over here. So how many holes? 1 minus B. So because these holes are recombining, so that is why there is a base current. Okay. So the base current is both due to the emitter current, which is due to these holes which are crossing base to emitter, and because of recombination of these holes. And because of the recombination of these holes, we are putting more electrons into the base via the base terminal. Okay. So one can find out the base current by this relation. Okay. So let us say that this relation is relation number 4 over here, equation 4. So from these, one can find out now, that is from equation number 1 and 4, one can find out IC by IB. Okay. So 1 was what? So 1 was this, IC is BIEP, and 4 is this one. Okay. So IC by B can be written. So IC is BIP and IB is this much. Okay. Now this can further be simplified into this form, where this is actually gamma. Okay. So both these are gamma, that is the emitter injection efficiency. We have already defined over here in this slide, that is IEP by IEN plus IEP is gamma. So we can replace these two by gamma. So if you replace this, so the IC by IB becomes equal to B gamma by 1 minus B gamma. Now B gamma we had already defined as alpha. Okay, in here B gamma was alpha, we had already defined. So we again use the same, that is B gamma replaced by alpha. So this becomes alpha by 1 minus alpha. And then finally alpha by 1 minus alpha, we say that is equal to beta. Okay. So this beta is actually the base to current, sorry, base to collector current amplification factor. Okay. So IC is now, sorry, IC by IB is now equal to beta, or the base current multiplied by beta is equal to the collector current. Okay. Now this is called base to collector current amplification factor. Okay. So since beta is larger than one, so obviously that would mean that this base current, which is input current, so that can be amplified, so that the output current, which is collector current, is an amplified version of the input current, which is base current. So the amplification factor is beta. Since beta is one, so this will provide real amplification. Now, since this alpha, the value of alpha, we had said that it is near unity. Okay. So even if it is unity, that is alpha is one over here, then so then this beta would become infinite, right? So that tells me that large values of beta can be actually obtained. Okay. In fact, for normal transistors, beta is somewhere around 50 to 200. And this value of beta can go up to 1000 for high frequency, low power transistors. So the beta value can go up to 1000. Okay. Now this IC by IB, which is equal to beta, so this is also equal to tau P by tau T, where tau P is the average whole lifetime in the base, and tau T is the transit time from emitter to collector, that is transit time, that is time taken by holes to cross emitter, sorry, holes to move from emitter to collector. Okay. So this IC by IB is beta, so that is also equal to the average hole lifetime in the base divided by the transit time from emitter to collector for holes. Okay. So this relation is important. Now this beta is also called HFE. H small fe. Okay. So when I say HFE, so I mean to say it is small signal AC gain. Okay. So for small signal AC amplifications, this beta is actually called H small fe. For large signal amplifications or DC gains, we call this beta as H capital FE. So H capital FE is again its same beta, that is current amplification factor, but this is used when amplifying the large signals, or it is called DC gain. Similarly, HFE when using, when we are trying to amplify small AC signal, or this is called AC gain. So this collector current can be controlled by, we had found, by small variations in the base current, right? So this is what we had commented so far, that is collector current can be controlled by small variations in the base current. Okay. So because beta is normally larger than 50, between 50 and 200 for normal transistors. Okay. Now let us consider a PNP transistor and let us try to bias this circuit. So common emitter configuration again. Okay. So now the base current can be generated via, this biasing circuit. Okay. And the value of tau P and tau T are given to us. Okay. So from this, IC by IB can be found. So IC by IB is beta, that is tau P by tau T. So that comes out to be, that is beta is somewhere around 100. So one can find out beta is 100. Now in this loop, that is base emitter loop. So since emitter base junction is forward biased and collector base junction is reverse biased, so this is the case of a forward active region. So from this loop, that is base emitter loop, one can find out the base current. If I know base to emitter voltage, which is VBE is, let us say 0.7 volts, okay, which is cut-in voltage of this PN junction diode. So if VBE is 0.7 volt and 5 volt battery is already connected over here, 50 kilo ohm resistance is also present here, one can find out the base current. Okay. Now let us make things simple by neglecting this VBE. So let us neglect this VBE, that is base to emitter voltage, and try to find out the base current. So the base current is given by now 5 volt DC supply divided by 50 kilo ohm resistance. Okay. So IB, that is base current, is 5 divided by 50, which is 0.1 milliampere. Okay. Now beta is already known to us, IB is also known to us, so IC can be found, that is collector current can be found, which comes out to be equal to, that is 0.1 milliampere multiplied by 100, so which is 10 milliamperes. So we saw that the current amplification has been achieved, that is base current input was 0.1 milliampere and the collector current at the output is now 10 milliampere. Now to the same circuit, one can apply a small signal AC, can be superimposed, that is some current source. Small signal current source can be superimposed on this DC supply and then one can find out the AC amplification of that current. So let us say that a small signal base current IB is applied here to this circuit and the base current's base current peak to peak value is 0.1 milliampere. Right? So the base current's peak to peak value is 0.1 milliampere, that is 0.05 plus 0.05, 0.1 milliampere. So since beta is 100, now this base current will be amplified and at the collector current, you will find 10 milliamperes peak to peak. Right? At the collector terminal, you will find AC collector current, which will be equal to, the magnitude will be equal to 10 milliamperes peak to peak, 5 plus 5, 10 milliamperes. Okay. Now, one important thing to notice here is, so that is very important to notice, that this collector current, this is actually not determined by this resistance which is appearing over here and this power supply over here, right? So if you try to apply, KCL in this loop and try to find out collector current, so that is not actually the collector current. So collector current is not dependent upon the resistor's value and also the voltage supply which is applied over here, right? In fact, the collector current only depends upon beta and IB, right? That is beta and the base current. It does not depend upon the battery and the resistor in the collector circuit. So it only depends upon beta and IB. It does not depend upon these two things. So that is a point to be remembered. Now let us summarize what we have read so far. So we had seen PNP, that is this one, and NPN transistors. Okay, and this is the case of a forward active region, that is forward active bias, that is emitter base junction is forward bias and collector base junction is reverse bias. So here also emitter base junction is forward bias and collector base junction is reverse bias. So one can notice the directions of the currents. Okay. So in a NPN transistor, right, so I'll write here NPN transistor. Okay. This is NPN transistor. In NPN transistor, the current direction is from collector to emitter, right? So because emitter is emitting electrons, so emitter emits electrons which reach collector. So which reach collector. So obviously, when electrons are moving from emitter to collector, the current will be from collector to emitter. So that is why the direction of current is into the collector and out of the emitter. Okay. And the base current direction, right? So that also has to be noticed. Base current direction is into the base. Okay. So now here the base is P type, that is holes are there in the base. Okay. Now, because electrons are now moving into the base, okay, so that means these electrons are recombining in the base. So holes are lost in the base because of recombination. So these lost holes have to be provided into the base by the base terminal. So the lost holes have to be provided by the base terminal to the base. So since the hole direction is into the base, so the current direction due to holes will also be into the base. Similarly, for a PNP transistor. So in a PNP transistor, again, I'll write this is P, this is N base, and again, this is P, P type collector. Now in a PNP transistor, the emitter emits holes which reach the collector. Okay. Now, since the direction of holes is from emitter to collector, okay, so therefore the current direction is also from emitter to collector, okay, because the current is in the same direction as the hole move, and opposite in the direction in which electron moves. So, but here it's hole, so we have the current also in the same direction, that is into the emitter and out of the collector. Now coming on to the base current. So base is n-type electrons, so which are lost due to recombination. So the emitter, sorry, the base terminal has to supply electrons into the base. So since electrons are now supplied into the base, the direction of the current will be opposite. So the current direction is opposite to the movement of electrons into the base. So that is why the base current is coming out of the base here. And then we have also discussed these equations, that is relationship between collector and emitter current, collector and base current, then beta and alpha. Okay, and then from these three, one can find out these three relations also. From these three, one can further find out these relations also. Okay. So, okay, we have time. Now, so far we have seen only the relationship between collector current, emitter current, and base current. But we have actually not calculated these collector, emitter, and base currents considering the minority carrier concentrations in the emitter, collector, or base regions, right? So in a PN junction diode, if you remember, we had calculated the diode current due to both electrons and holes. And for calculating the electron and hole current, we had utilized the minority carrier concentration profile in the P and N region, in P and junction diodes, and also via charge distributions in P and N region, we had calculated the electron and hole current. And then we had commented on, calculating the the current due to diffusion and drift in a P and junction. So same procedure we have to apply here also to find out the emitter current, collector current, and base current. Okay, that is first step would be to find out the excess hole distribution or excess hole concentration in the base. So that would be my first step. Okay. So to find out IC, IE, and IB, first step would be to solve for the excess hole distribution in the base, same as we had done in the PN junction. The second step would be to evaluate the emitter collector currents from the gradient of hole distributions on each side of the base. Considering it's a PNP transistor, so we are only talking about hole gradient because it's a PNP transistor. So for emitter current and collector current, one has to find out these currents from the gradient of hole distribution on the emitter and collector sides of the base. So these two things we have to perform. And then finally, third thing is that one can find out the base current from the current summation or from charge control analysis of recombination in the base. So we'll apply all these three things to find out the emitter, collector, and base current, right? Same as we had done for the PN junctions. Now, before that, we'll make several assumptions, and these assumptions are that number one, holes are diffusing from emitter to collector and drift is negligible in the base region. So this is number one assumption. Then two, we are assuming that emitter injection efficiency is one. That is, ammeter current is made up of entirely of holes. Third assumption we will make is that collector saturation current or collector reverse saturation current is negligible, because collector junction is reverse biased, so reverse currents can also be possible in that PN junction, which is at the collector base. So we are assuming reverse currents or collector saturation current is negligible. Then of course steady state it is, since you know, we'll be biasing the transistor into forward active mode, so the currents will be, currents and voltages will be in steady state or non-equilibrium state. Okay. So let us try to find out. So let us apply first step, that is to solve for excess hole distributions in the base. So for calculating the excess hole distribution in the base, one has to find out the solution of the diffusion equation in the base region. Okay. Solution of diffusion equation in the base region, similar to what we had done in the PN junction. I'll show you where we had done earlier. But before that, let us define that we have a PNP transistor of this kind. An emitter base junction is forward bias, collector base junction is reverse bias. And the effective base width is this much. That is 0 to WB. So this is my effective base width. And in equilibrium, we had already seen the energy band diagram, how it looks, and then how it changes when you know, the transistor is in normal active mode. So we had commented already on this, so we'll not go into this again. But yes, let us consider that this structure or this device structure we have. Now, for this device structure, one can find out the excess hole concentration at the edge of the emitter depletion region. That is, at this edge, one can find out the excess hole concentration, which is delta PE. Similarly, the excess hole concentration at the collector edge on the base side, so that is delta PC. Okay. So excess hole concentration at this edge, emitter edge, and excess hole concentration at the collector edge can be found similar to what we had done in the case of PN junction. So I'll go back to slide 116, where we had calculated the same thing, that is excess hole concentration, okay, for PN junction. I'll go back to slide number 116 and show you where we had done the same thing. Okay. So I'll go back to 116 slide. Slide number 116. Here, right? So we have to find out delta PE and delta PC, that is excess minority carrier concentration. So I'll go to 116. So in 116, it is present over here. So excess hole concentration, which is at this edge, which is delta PN. So delta PN is given by PN0 e to the power VD by VT minus 1. Delta PN is PN0, PN0 is equilibrium carrier concentration, and total you know, carrier concentration at this edge is equilibrium carrier concentration plus excess carrier concentration. So we had read this in PN junction diode. So we'll simply use this equation, that is delta PN is PN0 e to the power VD by VT minus 1. We'll simply use this equation, PN0 e to the power VD by VT minus 1. But since we are using emitter base, you know, biasing, so we'll replace this VD by VEB. And for collector base biasing, we'll replace this VD by VCB. Okay. I'll go back again to the same slide where we were. So we were here. So excess carrier concentration, that is delta P on emitter side, is PN e to the power QVEB by KT minus 1. So there it was QVD, but since here that diode, that is this diode, PN junction diode on the emitter base side, so that has been provided VEB. The biasing is VEB. So we replace VD, that is diode voltage, by VEB. Similarly, the excess hole concentration on the collector edge, that is this edge, delta PC. So that is given by the same relation. Now PNQ e to the power Q VCB, right? So here it's VCB now. DCB by KT minus 1. So VCB by KT and VEB by KT. So this gives me excess hole concentrations at the emitter edge and the collector edge. Now, if the forward bias is strong and also reverse bias applied is strong, right? Since we are making this emitter base junction forward bias and collector base junction reverse bias, and now we say that both forward and reverse bias are very strong. So very strong here means VEB is greater than, much greater than KT by Q. Forward bias and reverse bias, that is VCB, is very much less than zero. So if we say VEB here is very much greater than KT by Q, so that means this term will have no effect because this term will be very large, right? So one can write delta PE as this, right? PN E Q to the QVEB by KT. Similarly, when VCB is very much less than zero, so this term becomes zero. Now we are left with only minus PN over here, right? So excess carrier concentration profile or carrier concentration at the edges of emitter and collector, that now is given by this relation. Now let us call these two relations as 8AB equation, and these two relations let us call as equation 9AB. Now, using diffusion equation and its solution in a steady state, similar to what we had done for the PN junction diode from slide 80. So I'll go back to slide 80 to find out the diffusion equation and its solution in steady state, which is actually given by these two relations, 10 and 11. Right? So I'll show you, we had similar 10 and 11 relation at slide number 80 when we had studied PN junction diode. I'll go back to slide number 80 and show you where we had done the same thing for PN junction diode. So this is slide number 80, and we have to see this diffusion equation solution, right? Slide 80. This is slide 80. So diffusion equation in steady state, right? So this equation we are again utilizing in the PN junctions present in the transistor also. And then the solution of this differential equation. So we have discussed, this is the solution of this differential equation, that is eta px is c1 e to the x by lp plus c2 e to the minus x by lp. Okay. So this actually gives me the minority carrier concentration profile in this region. Okay. So we'll utilize these two. Okay. So we'll utilize these two, that is the diffusion equation and its solution. I'll go back now to where we were actually. Okay, so we were here. Yeah, here. So using the same differential equation as we had for the diodes, the PN junction diode, one can write this differential equation, okay, and its solution, which is given by this. Okay. Since the holes are diffusing, so we have to utilize this diffusion equation for holes, okay? And the solution of diffusion equation is of this form. Now the boundary conditions can be applied, okay? So the boundary conditions in this differential equation and its solution can be applied for the BJT, and the boundary condition in case of BJT is that the minority carrier concentration profile at xn is equal to zero. That is xn is equal to zero. At xn is equal to zero, I simply say xn is zero here in this case. So this eta p at xn is equal to zero becomes c1 plus c2, which is actually delta PE. That is minority carrier concentration profile at the emitter edge. So at the emitter edge, this is xn. So at the emitter edge, that is xn is equal to zero, one can find out the minority carrier concentration profile. So which is eta p xn. Eta p at xn is equal to zero is now c1 plus c2, which is actually delta PE. Similarly, at xn is equal to wb. Okay. So at xn is equal to wb, that is at this point. So at xn is equal to wb, the total minority carrier concentration is delta pc. So again, that can be found from the solution of the differential equation. So simply we replace xn by wb. So this xn which we had in the solution of the differential equation, so this xn is replaced by w. So we are the p is equal to delta pc. From these two equations, one can find solve for similar to what we had done for the diode, right? Same thing we are doing here, nothing different. Now solving for C1 and C2 gives me C1 as this and C2 as this, which are, let us say, which is equation number 13. Now from equation number 11 and 13, 13 is in front of us, 11, I'll go back, 11 is this, solution of differential equation. So from 11 and 13, one can find out the full expression for the excess hole distribution in the base. Considering a strong reverse bias at the collector junction, which we have already assumed, and the equilibrium hole concentration, PN we are taking as negligible compared with the injected concentration, right? So delta PE, that is injected carrier concentration, is since larger than the equilibrium carrier concentration of holes in the base. So that is why we say that let us neglect this equilibrium concentration of hole in the base, that is PN, and let us say the total concentration of hole is only because of injected carrier concentration in the base, which is actually delta PE. Okay. So using 11, 13 and these approximations, one can find out now eta P. So eta P now is equal to this much. Using 13 and the solution of the differential equation, which is given by 11, and also assuming delta PC is 0. So one can find out eta PXN as this. Now one can also visualize the minority carrier concentration profile in emitter, base and collector, same as what we have done in the diode. So minority carrier concentration in P region is n-type electrons. Okay. So equilibrium carrier concentration NP plus excess minority carrier concentration eta N. So which actually decreases as you move into the emitter side. Okay. Similarly, the minority carrier concentration in n-type base is holes in n-type base. Similarly, the minority carrier concentration in P-type collector is electrons in P-type collector. Okay. So minority carrier concentration profile can also be found similar to what we had done in the case of the diode. Okay. Now our next job is the evaluation of the terminal currents, that is collector current, base current and emitter current. Since now we have found out the minority carrier concentration profile, so from the gradient of the minority carrier concentration profile, right, so this we have found eta P. So from the gradient of the minority carrier concentration profile, one can find out the hole current. So this would be again similar to what we had done for the diode. So I'll go back to slide number 103. Okay. And we'll see in slide number 103 where we had done the same for diode, how to find out the hole current from the gradient of hole concentration at each depletion region H. Okay. So I'll go back to slide number 103. I'll take maybe 5 more minutes. Okay. So I'll go back to 103, slide number 103 here. So for PN junctions, we have to find out this, that is hole current from the gradient of the hole concentration. So 103. So here we have found here this one. Okay. So this one. that is whole current from the gradient of whole concentration, right? So we'll utilize the same, okay? Same for calculating the current in the transistor. Okay? I'll go back to our main discussion, which is here. Okay, so we utilize the same equation here, okay, for the transistor. So one can find out the current, that is x, the current due to holes at xn. Okay. So that can be given by this relation, minus qa dp d by dxn of eta pxn, that is the gradient of minority carrier concentration. Now when this expression is evaluated at xn is equal to 0, so when this expression is evaluated at xn is equal to 0, okay, so where is xn is equal to 0? I'll go back again and show you. Xn is equal to 0 means this point, okay. So at xn is equal to 0, it gives the whole component of the emitter current. Okay. Now here we'll utilize equation number 12a and 15. This is 15 and 12a, that is this equation at xn is equal to 0. Okay. So using equation number 12a, this one, and equation number 15 here, that is eta p, basically we bring in from equation number 12a, we bring in eta p. So one can write that the emitter current due to holes, which is actually the hole current at xn is equal to 0, is equal to qa times dp by lp c2 minus c1, where dp is the diffusivity of holes, lp is the diffusion length of the holes. Okay. So this also actually dp by lp relation comes from slide number 103, when dp is already present over here. Now evaluating equation number 15 at xn is equal to wb, one can find out the collector current, right? So at xn is equal to 0, we have emitter current, and xn is equal to wb, one can find out the collector current. So xn is equal to 0, I'll again go back here, at xn is equal to 0, one can find out emitter current at this point, and at xn is equal to wb, that is this xn is equal to wb, one can find out the collector current. So now let us find out at xn is equal to wb, the collector current can be found. Okay. So at xn is equal to wb, we simply put, for the solution of this differential equation, we put, the solution we had this here, that is this was the solution. So here we put, we utilize this equation, 12b for eta p. So for value of this eta p xn, we utilize equation 12b and 15. Right? So I'll write 12b also we have to utilize. 12b and 15 also we are utilizing to find out this collector current, which is actually now this much, where c1 and c2. So we have calculated the c1 and c2 value in equation number 13 here. Right? So c1 and c2 from equation 13 can be put into this equation. Okay. So c1 and c2, when you put, then this equation, that is emitter current due to holes, is now equal to this much. Now this can further be simplified using the definitions of hyperbolic functions. So remembering that tan x is actually e to the power x minus e to the power minus x by e to the power x plus e to the power minus x, right? So here also in this equation we are getting the similar relation, that is e to the power x plus e to the power minus x divided by e to the power x minus e to the power minus x. So this can be represented by hyperbolic functions, okay? So in fact this function ctnh, that is 1 by tan hyperbolic x, so that can be applied here to this equation. So if you apply this here, that is hyperbolic function definition in this equation, then the emitter current equation now turns into this form, right? That is We have applied. I mean, this is e to the power x plus e to the power minus x divided by e to the power x minus e to the power minus x. So this is CTNH. That is this one. Then minus 2 delta PC divided by e to the power x minus e to the power minus x. So that can be e to the power x minus e to the power minus, that is this one. So these two can be substituted, right? CSCH and CTNH, that is 1 by sine hyperbolic x and 1 by tan hyperbolic x. So that can be utilized here. Okay. So we get emitter current as this and collector current one can find out as this. Let us say that these two equations are 18AB. Now here, if we assume that emitter current is solely due to emitter current due to holes, that is gamma is 1 if we assume, okay, then one can find out the total base current. So the total base current would be equal to emitter current minus collector current, right? So simply we subtract the collector current from this emitter current to find out the base current. So the base current can also be found. So we have seen here that using the concentration gradient profile of the minority carriers in the base, one can find out emitter current, collector current, and the base current. So I think I'll stop here, and then maybe we can talk more from here in the next lecture. If you have any queries, then please ask.
Excuse me, sir.
Yeah, please.
Sir, इस subject में सब मेरी मतलब derivation में बहुत problem आती है.
Okay, so you can see my lectures. I've already uploaded them.